So square that circle for me. You know, we're all against China and we're all together on this. At the same time, we might cut you off if you keep doing business with China. Where are we?
Well, I mean, the transatlantic relationship is not dead, but let's be clear. This is the most fundamental structural divide that we've seen since the creation of NATO. The Americans in attendance, not just the Trump administration, but the Democrats, the CODEL, the congressional delegation, the senators, Pelosi, all of them were saying, you Europeans, China is the most significant national security threat for the United States. This is a wholesale pivot of the Americans towards Asia, worried about China. There were no Europeans in agreement. So, there were none.
So I saw the Nancy Pelosi statement, which was quite strong, actually,
yes.
Came out. So are they right? I mean, is the Trump administration and the Democrats on the Hill right that Huawei is that perilous a threat to the United States' national security?
I certainly believe that the reality of a decoupling in technology of the United States and China from one another, that our tech companies like Google and Amazon and Facebook don't have access into China, their companies are not going to get access into the U.S., and the Chinese will work to export their data, their standards, their surveillance to other countries. That's a shift away from globalization that has precipitous implications for the geopolitical balance. Clearly, I would argue that the rise of China as a committed state capitalist and authoritarian nation is the most important strategic threat to the U.S. But the fact that the Europeans want none of it, the fact that they don't trust the Americans because of the background of Snowden, for example, and our own surveillance, our unilateralism, Trump's orientation towards them on trade, the fact that we don't necessarily have a really strong alternative to Huawei right now in the United States, the Europeans were saying, we're just not going there. And I have to say that if the Europeans aren't prepared to support the United States for what we consider to be the most important national security threat, you have to ask yourself why the Americans down the road would be providing the kind of security umbrella that we have heretofore and putting the money in to help the Europeans vis-a-vis Russia. And I think that's a legitimate question that's going to be asked by Americans.
But Ian, I'd love to ask you, as someone who moves back and forth between Europe and the US, I live in New York, but I obviously in London quite a lot as well, what do you think, as someone who knows China well, about the level of danger around Huawei? Is it really a tool of the Chinese government, as Americans in Washington would all say?
I certainly believe that the data that Huawei has access to will be made available to the Chinese government as they find that useful. So the strategic alignment, the idea that Huawei is a national champion in the way that Lockheed Martin has been a national champion of the U.S. government historically, at the very least, yes, I do believe that. But more importantly, I think when we talk about 5G, we're not just talking about smartphones, we're talking, as you know, about the Internet of Things. It's the entire data infrastructure around smart cities, anything with a chip in it. And the idea that that would be aligned to a Chinese set of standards as opposed to an American set of standards with our allies, even though it's cheaper, even though it's rolling out more quickly, does strike me as something the Americans need to take very seriously.
Ian, this is what I don't get. Thus far, I've only heard stick. If you don't play our game the way we want, then we're going to cut you off,
yeah,
right?
Right.
Where's the carrot? I mean, part of the problem is, as you said, there's not alternatives in the
That's
United
right.
States for
yeah.
5G. Why doesn't the United States invest in Nokia? Why doesn't it invest in Ericsson and things like that, where we could together develop yeah. 5G and not need Huawei?
Well, of course, this was the speech that was given by Attorney General Bill Barr, who has a telecom background, among other things, just 2 weeks ago. And he suggested, in addition to some urgent FCC decisions that would need to be made in terms of bandwidth made available to make 5G work, but also the idea that the Americans, a public sector supported consortium, industrial policy, dirty word for most Republicans.
Coming would, from a Republican government,
exactly.
let us say.
Quite
no free markets, hello.
That's right.
Yeah. Except Republican governments during the Cold War yep. were very supportive of the military-industrial complex. So what you have Barr saying is we need a military-industrial technological complex because the Chinese are fighting the Cold War very differently. And I understand that, but that's, his one speech is not a policy. And you're absolutely right that the Europeans see a lot of money coming from Belt and Road, particularly in the 17+1, the East and Southern Europeans with the Chinese. They, even the Italians, right, joined Belt and Road for a reason. The Brits are saying it's a cheaper system. Why are we going to come to the U.S. unless it's something for us? They don't have the companies. So unless we're finding a way to help build up the Europeans as well, it's hard to imagine that they're going to simply say, yeah, we're going to go with you, America first, Trump.
Well, Nokia right? and Ericsson have actually said no.
Yeah.
They've said, well, thanks so much, but actually, no. And if you talk to people in Brussels these days, I mean, there's a line I've heard of them saying is, well, you know, American companies are using their data gathering information through American tech companies. We don't know what's happening with that. As you say, there's absolutely
there's no trust.
Fundamental lack of trust and a big split.
But again, my point is you raise that and you're right to raise it, but there's also the issue that the Europeans continue to significantly underspend compared to their targets on NATO. Russia is a much bigger proximate threat to the Europeans than the United States. Syrian refugees, same thing. I mean, Macron was the other big speech that you didn't show, but you know, don't have so much time. And his speech was also geopolitically unmoored. Yeah. He was talking about the fact that France and Europe needs to have a new European defense policy, which sounds great. But to say it 2 weeks after the UK has left the EU and a week after Angela Merkel's preferred successor, AKK, has actually resigned in ignominy from running the party. Right. I mean, Macron may have strong ideas about Europe, but Europe has no capacity to follow them.
Well, I just want to know what...
I'm sorry, I just want to move from Munich up to Brussels.
Because we could spend a lot of time on this.
Well, we could, and we should, but Mark Zuckerberg and his visit to Brussels this week, where Mike went and said, look, we want regulation now. We really need regulation to reestablish our trust with our users. Yeah. This is part of what Mark, over the years, has said. It hasn't always been consistent.
I think that it is inevitable that there will need to be some regulation. We're going to take a number of measures, from building and deploying new AI tools that take down fake news, to growing our security team to more than 20,000 people, to making it so that we verify every advertiser who's doing political and issue ads, to make sure that that kind of interference that the Russians were able to do in 2016 is going to be much harder for anyone to pull off in the future.
Chairwoman, our policy is that we do not fact-check politicians' speech. We believe that people should be able to see for themselves what politicians are saying.
People should be able to see for themselves what politicians are saying.
We believe that in a democracy, it is important that people can see for themselves what politicians are saying.
Now, I know many people disagree with this, but in general, I don't think it's right for a private company to censor politicians or the news in a democracy.
So I don't know, you, Ian, I have a tough time drawing a straight line through all of that, exactly what Facebook's approach is.
Well, I think the straight line is that Mark Zuckerberg lacks personal affect. I think that that's fairly consistent through all of those little bits that you had there.
But what are they looking for?
Well, in the United States, his argument is increasingly we're the national champion if you try to break us up. I mean, he says things like Elizabeth Warren is an existential threat to Facebook. That was another quote of his. No, China's perhaps an existential threat to Facebook. And in the United States, among many circles, that's compelling for the reasons we just discussed. In Europe, it's not, right? For very obvious reasons. They don't buy it. They don't trust the Americans. They think of the American companies as being exploitative and undermining democracies. Yeah. And the European Union has come out with some very significant new regulations that are much greater and broader than GDPR that would affect the way that AI would be tested, that data would be controlled, and would put significant limitations on an organization like Facebook's ability to operate inside Europe.
Well, you're way ahead of us on data privacy across the board, wouldn't you say?
Yes, I mean, of course.
So, and China, on the other hand, doesn't seem to care much about data privacy, which you could argue is why their e-commerce business has taken off a lot faster than even ours here in the
U.S. They care greatly about it. They want to ensure that it doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist, right?
And they're making a lot of money as a consequence. No, they have they have so much. They have 50 times as much the Chinese digital data in digital commerce as the Americans do. And that's because it's vertically integrated, it's subsidized by the state, and there are zero privacy concerns. Mm. And that is the exact antithesis of what you see in Europe today.
But here's a bit of irony, you know, following on from the weird and wacky fact that suddenly you may have a Republican government championing industrial policy and trying to persuade Silicon Valley to go socialist and come together and actually work together building a 5G system. The other big irony is, who would have guessed 10 years ago that Silicon Valley's standards will be set in Brussels? I mean, GDPR is essentially impacting global companies all over the world.
So, again, to go back, I don't think it's ironic that Republicans want to strengthen a military-industrial complex with tech companies. I really don't. Even though the Americans say they hate socialism, the reality is these things are ideal types. But when we talk about Europe, its superpower is regulation. They have the world's largest common market, companies want in, and they're deeply effective at being able to take those rules and other people want to align with them. Unfortunately, as you know, they don't have companies. And, I mean, they're not creating the next round of Googles and Amazons and Facebooks. And so I see the Germans and French now saying, even though we have this strong regulatory power, we also want to have industrial policy that'll ring fence and allow us to build our own national champions. And I think, number one, that has the potential to erode the regulatory capacity globally. Mm-hmm. And also, it will delay the ability of the Europeans to have efficiency and be productive while not being very effective at building up their own company. So I think that your point, which is precisely that GDPR is now picked up in California, that's their strength. And they should stick with it, but they're not.
Well, the other implication is suddenly industrial policy is coming back into fashion everywhere.